finding myself in the midst of you. Beyond music, beyond the noise, all that I need is to be with you. And in the quiet, I hear your voice, word of God speak, which you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty. Be still and know you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God speak, would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty. To be still and know you're in his place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay.
You know, Abby opened, and the praise band opened with a song that said, everybody has a story to tell. I have a story to tell. This is the beginning of the most important 8 days in Christian history. I might go so far as to even say, this is the beginning of the most important days in modern history, because our time has been set in BC and AD, AD being in the year of our Lord. The story I want to tell you this morning, I want you to go with me and I want you to imagine. I want you to use your best imagination, and I want you to picture a very rocky, dry land with brush and sheep and warmth. And I want you to imagine a very special rabbi taking 12 disciples and heading into Jerusalem. Now, for every Sunday of Lent, I have told you about an outrageous act of love that Jesus, this rabbi, perpetrated, if you will, to choreograph this very moment when he would be heading into Jerusalem and he would be confronting the very personages who were out to stop him. So he takes his group and he leads them down these dusty roads, dust whirling up at their feet, and he says to them, to two of his disciples, I want you to go ahead into Jerusalem. And I want you to go to a house, and there you're going to find a donkey with a foal. And I want you to gather it, and I want you to bring it back to me. Right away, his disciples said, but Jesus, what are we supposed to tell the owner of this donkey and foal? He said, just tell him the master has need of them. And they did. They went. They secured the donkey and the foal. Surely, as they thought would happen, the owner comes out and said, where are you going with my property? They just replied, the master has need of him. That was all it took. He said, go. They took them, and they took them to Jesus. And he said, I am going to ride this foal that has never been ridden into Jerusalem. And I know they wondered why. We know why. It was to fulfill the prophecy from Zechariah that the Messiah would come on a foal that had never been ridden into Jerusalem. So his disciples, they put their coats up on there to make the colt a little more comfortable, and Jesus mounted him, and they go down into Jerusalem. They don't quite know what to expect, but they knew it was Passover, and more crowds joined them on the road. And pretty soon it was almost too difficult to walk for the masses of people that were headed down to the gates of Jerusalem. And people ran ahead and they said, Jesus is coming. The man is coming. The one that heals the sick. The one that turned water into wine. The one that raised a man from the dead. He is coming. He is coming into Jerusalem. He is coming. And the crowds just began to gather more and more and more. And they stripped off palm branches and they were waving them, waiting for him to come. And some of them thought he might be the Messiah. Some of them prayed he might be the Messiah. Some of them doubted that he was the Messiah. Nevertheless, he rode proudly into Jerusalem. Now, those that were wondering if he was the Messiah began to wonder, well, why is he coming in on a donkey? Wouldn't our King of Kings, our Lord of Lords, our Messiah be riding in on a majestic stallion? They didn't get it. His disciples didn't get it. And sadly, many of us today don't get it. But still they were caught up in the fervor of the mob. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And he rode in majestically, smiling and looking at the crowd. And as he looked at each precious face to him, he wondered, I wonder where you'll be on Friday when they arrest me. I wonder where you'll be on Friday when they make me carry my cross. I wonder where you'll be on Friday when they nail me to that cross. Will you still be singing, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest? Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Or will you be among those shouting, crucify him, crucify him? Will you be a believer? Will you be a doubter? Jesus knew that this was a turning point in history. Jesus knew what lay ahead of him, but he did not turn back. He kept his face pointed directly toward Calvary. He kept his face pointed toward Thursday night when we would have his last meal together with his disciples. And one at the table would doubt him, one would betray him, one would deny him. Others wanted to be on his right hand or his left hand. They were jockeying for position. They still didn't get it. where would they be on Friday? In the Garden of Gethsemane on Thursday night, a beautiful olive grove, a stream trickling through. This procession led there. And in that garden, after the Last Supper, our Savior knelt and he wept. And he cried out to his Father, Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. His last fully human emotion emerging in his anxiety and his fear. And he wept, and his tears and sweat fell like blood. Those that were sitting with him still didn't get it. They slept. Are we asleep? Where are we in this story? Where are we in the procession? Are we singing Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord? On Thursday night at the table, are we doubting, betraying, or denying? Are we jockeying for some important, powerful position? Where are we in the garden when he's praying and weeping? Are we sleeping? These 8 days give us time during Easter to really, really think about our faith and where we are in our faith journey. Where are we? Where will we be when he's arrested, when he's being tormented, when he goes before Pilate and they say, crucify him? Will we speak out? Will we be silent? When he walks the Via Dolorosa, will we offer to carry the cross? Will we wipe his brow? When they nail him, will we know that with each hammer fall, it is our sins that he is paying for? So much to think about this week. So much to think about in this story. Where are we? Do we 21st century Christians get it? Do we understand that the least shall be first? Do we understand that what looks like abject failure is the most supreme victory that was ever, ever occurring in the history of all mankind? Do we get it? Ask yourselves this week. Read and reread and reread in all four Gospels the story. This story. It's my story. It's your story. In the book of Joshua, he speaks out and says, as for me and my house, I will follow the Lord. I pray that each of us can change that slightly as we go through this week, as we think to decide that we can cry out, as for me and my house, he is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. He is the one that God sent to suffer and die. By his stripes we are healed. By his death we are justified justified. Just imagine, it's just as if I'd never sinned. And then comes Easter. But that's a story for another Sunday. So I just ask that you take with you this week these questions. Where am I in the crowd as he rides into Jerusalem? Where am I at the table as he dines with his beloved friends? Where am I in the garden? Where am I when he's arrested? And where am I when he is crucified? I pray you'll think on these things this week, and you will know that this is the greatest story that was ever told. In the name of God who loves you, Christ who died for you, and the Holy Spirit that will lead, guide, and direct you every day of your life. And the faithful say, amen.
We're going to finish the service with "I've Never Seen a Rainbow."
To seeing you Easter. Be kind to yourself, be kind to others. We'll see you next week.